faculty that took the time to come out. We will begin with each speaker telling us a little bit about the use of technology in what research they do, and we will start off with questions after that. And you are, of course, welcome to join in anytime.
Hi, I'm Paula Winke. I'm at Michigan State University, and basically we use technology to research the use of technology. So we have, what I was talking about yesterday is we use two different eye trackers, a Tobii TX300, and we also have an iLink 1000. We just applied for an iLink 1000 Plus, so we soon might have three eye trackers. But we use them to study, in particular, the use of captions during video-based listening exercises across multiple languages to see how students take advantage of captions or if they don't. We look at input enhancement techniques, so materials design, and in particular computer-mediated communication using the Tobii, and also online testing behaviors using the Tobii as well.
I'm Mark Hasegawa-Johnson from the University of Illinois. I guess it would be more relevant for me to talk about the use of language science and linguistics in my research. I designed automatic speech recognition understanding systems, and generally where I've had the biggest impact is by taking knowledge of dependent variables that have been demonstrated in laboratory studies in phonology and in linguistics and building speech recognition systems, ASR systems, that are actually sensitive to that dependence. So, for example, one of our first impact systems was the automatic prosody dependent speech recognition, where the acoustic models for every vowel in the language are different depending on whether the word has a pitch accent on it or not, and the word final syllable, the acoustic models of the phones in the last syllable of the word are different depending on whether the word precedes an intonational phrase boundary or not. And we demonstrated an improvement in error rate by doing that. Another thing that we've done is based on, I guess you could call it a set of psycholinguistic models, the landmark-based speech perception models that Ken Stevens developed, which suggested that that listeners are more sensitive to that phonological distinctions are made signaled more clearly right at the instant of consonant closure and consonant release. And so we've developed, and so what we did was pulled out a lot of examples of such consonant closure and release instances from Timmit and trained discriminative classifiers to make the distinctive feature, the binary distinctive feature distinctions using centered at the consonant release or consonant closure. More recently, I've been looking a lot at questions of theoretical machine learning in the sense of can you improve the error rate for a particular number of transcribers by using active learning or by using crowdsourcing or by using transfer learning, where you have information from from the wrong database, but you want to apply it in order to get as much information from it as you can, and very recently, although this hasn't really shown up in any of our published work yet, we're starting to realize that that's a linguistic question too, because it comes down to essentially if you have a database of English and what you really would like to build is a Turkish language speech recognizer, then the hard questions turn out to be what are the similarities and differences between English and Turkish, and if you can code those in advance, then you can build a better transfer learning system. So that's where we are right now.
So as I talked about on Friday, I do some work in cognitive modeling, taking cognitive architectures and writing language components like parsers and semantic interpreters and so on, integrating those to understand language task interactions. We use that in other types of frameworks like information extraction, ontology-based specifications where people can specify the concepts they're looking for in text and have that information extracted automatically and for downstream processing. Another area that I'm working in, we have a corpus annotation research group where we're annotating a corpus of Syriac, several million words of Syriac. Syriac is a Semitic language where there aren't a lot of experts available to help in the annotation process, but we've developed an automatic process for doing lower levels of annotation, part of speech tagging, and morpheme identification, parsing out words for morphemes. And right now we're working on dictionary linkage, which is kind of like lemmatization, but then you also have to take the root form and do other modifications to be able to look them up in a dictionary. With this, we're working with active learning as well, and also crowdsourcing some of the annotations to try and get as many people as possible to help in that process. One final area that we're working in that I'll mention is called elicited imitation, which is a language proficiency test where you engineer sentences of varying difficulty in terms of vocabulary level and grammatical structure, morphological, syntactic, and so on, and length in syllables from very short to very long. And given a wide enough range of these sentences, you construct a test which can be done by hand or can be automated in a way like we heard this morning. And so people listen to these sentences and then just speak them back. They're too long to that you for just parroting back the sentences to work. But by just scoring their response automatically using forced alignment, a technique that we heard about today, we used Sphinx for that, or Julius, depending on what language we're testing. We're able to administer around 50 sentences of varying difficulty levels and arrive with an automatically derived score that correlates pretty nicely with more traditional methods like oral proficiency interviews and so on, which are longer and more expensive to administer. So we use these we've developed tests for several languages. These are used in not as high stakes situations, but for placement or gauging proficiency without having to go to the expense of an OPI. We're not trying to replace OPIs, we're just trying to develop a tool that can be used in less important situations, but that come up all the time where we're working.
Hi, I'm Chilin. I'm here at UIUC. So I would say that my technically related work are probably in two big areas. One is corpus studies and corpus analysis of speech and sound. Then the use of technology is pretty mundane work of doing the work as fast as possible and as accurate as possible. So in this way, I would just pull any of the available technologies. The ones I use most often are speech technologies and language testing technologies, and some of that I talk about in the morning. Just pull them together so that they solve some problems down the line. The other big areas of technologically related work is actually learning attributes in the speech corpus, in particular in tone and intonation, using machine learning methods. So that is a combination of trying to explaining cognitive or categorical representation that matter to the listeners and find those attributes in a large corpus, because if we understand technology and can harness technologies, we can do a much better, a much larger scope of work which has more robust results. So that is the primary reasons that I will actually promote the use of technology in linguistic research.
Okay, so I don't use a lot of technology in my own work beyond acoustic analysis. So, but what I want to impress upon you is how the use of just this simple technology has changed the way we teach and do phonology within my academic lifetime. So when I was in grad school, I never saw a spectrogram. So phonology was purely symbolic. You just had transcriptions and you played with the symbols. And to arrive to generalizations. Now we know that many of the rules that we posited were based on, you know, generalizations that are not really always surface true, that there's much more variation that was assumed because, you know, things had to be categorical. That's the way. And the reason why we never saw spectrogram was because it was very difficult to produce spectrogram. So when I first got here, there was a KLA metrics spectrograph downstairs in the lab. They was, oh yeah, you can do that. So it takes 5 minutes to produce. So you record one word, takes 5 minutes to, you know, get the picture. Then with a ruler, you can start measuring things, and that's the way PONEX was done, right? So you measured a few tokens and then reported the findings. So I was interested. I had this idea that some Basque dialects had a contrast, a pitch accent contrast, with lexical pitch accent. But, you know, this was by year stuff. So how do you do that? Well, you know, you make a narrowband spectrogram, and then you follow the 10 harmonic with a, you know, pencil and so on, and then you get a picture of that. That was the technology. So when we taught phonology here, when I started 25 years ago, it was, no, we didn't use any acoustic analysis. And then things started to change rapidly. So, but I remember the first, you know, 5 years after I was here, in a few labs they started to do intonational analysis, which until then was also just perceptual. They thought, okay, this goes up, this goes down. And really big mistakes were made that way. I mean, it turns out that the perception of intonation is very difficult because it doesn't convey the same kind of lexical meaning as tone does in Chinese. So it was, you know, idealized. You know, I think I hear a rise and a fall here, whatever. And turns out that, but you know, there was this program called X Waves, which was really expensive. So only a few labs had this program, and they produced the bulk of all research on intonation. Then there was another program that for intonation pitch works. That was only $500, so more people started buying it. And then Pratt came along, which is a free software program, and that has completely radically changed the way we teach and do phonology. So, okay, we'll stop here.
Randall Sadler, also from Illinois. Continuing on the trend of how things have changed, so I was sitting here listening to the other people, I realized I've just celebrated a 10th anniversary of collaboration with a colleague in Barcelona, Autonomous University of Barcelona in Spain. My research tends to focus more on the socio side and pedagogical research, and we started collaborating 10 years ago doing teacher exchange and younger student language training, primarily with students who are native speakers of Catalan. I don't speak any Catalan, by the way. I was thinking back then, we did a presentation about that recently. When we started, our cool high-tech tools were MOOs, those of you who remember MOOs, text-based chat rooms. And right about then, Yahoo Instant Messaging came out, and that was thrilling for us. No video, no audio, it was just text. So in the time that we've been doing the research together, we've been looking at some of the more socio elements. My particular interest is virtual worlds in language learning, and one of the exciting innovations that's happening right now, some of you have heard of in the news, Oculus Rift, for example. Oculus Rift is a virtual reality headset, but we're getting to the stage now where those are starting to come out commercially and, relatively speaking, cheap. And I think within the next few years, those prices will go down drastically. So in terms of gamification research, virtual reality research, this is a time right now when some exciting things will happen. Traditionally, in virtual worlds, of course, you've got your screen. It's a 3D environment in front of you on the screen. If anybody's played World of Warcraft, I mean, you're familiar with that sort of an environment. Virtual worlds aren't, you know, to kill elves and dwarves. They have a different function. But the difference with this virtual reality gear like Oculus Rift that's coming out, and there's research being done at Illinois on other ways to integrate experience into virtual worlds, like specialized gloves to manipulate objects in virtual worlds. It's really going to change, I think, the way we interact. One of the criticisms has been things like you're in a virtual world, a group of 6 people sitting there. And occasionally one of their mouths will move at random and speech will come out, but there's no facial expression. There's little in the way of natural, what we would consider natural movement. This is changing in a way that the kind of movement, nonverbal communication and verbal communication that will occur in these virtual worlds will much more closely reflect what's happening in real life. And that has very interesting implications for language learners and for research into things like pragmatics and you name it. So it's an area that I'm excited about. I do not own a headset yet. I'm hoping they'll come down in price some more. In terms of the other research that we're doing together, working with the young language learners, we've been using virtual worlds and machinima, which are movies made in virtual environments, to provide students, the latest was an exchange between 7-year-olds in Barcelona and 7-year-olds in Austria. Both of those groups were learning English. Virtual worlds like Second Life, the normal age of entry is 13 at the youngest. 7, 13, they weren't quite there. So we filmed the movies in Second Life to do things to introduce these students to more advanced vocabulary than they normally would have been able to attain. In this case, we set up a situation where myself and Melinda played researchers from the future. So our avatars are dressed up as futuristic scientists. And we recruited these students in these two countries to help us with three subjects who had unhealthy habits. These are 7-year-olds, right? So the name of our subjects were Hungry Helga, Stinky Susan, and Game Boy Gary. And we recruited them as our young scientists, the students, to help us diagnose what was wrong, to suggest ways that these students could improve. Now, keep in mind, this is all in English. 7 years old, they're beginning language students, but they were able to produce English that absolutely blew their teachers away. So ways to use technology to bring students to another level in language learning. So I'm interested in that area.
If any of you have questions, we can start the discussion on the work that they do with technology.
So this is kind of a broad, overarching. This is open for everyone. One thing that we're finding in a lot of everyone's research is, you know, very similar foci, if you want to call it. Just you're focusing on a lot of different areas of linguistics and non-linguistic questions, using similar technologies, using dissimilar technologies. But how do we? I mean, I'm a graduate student here. How do we start incorporating, I mean, it seems as though everyone is working kind of around this basic idea that there's one centralized question. I don't know if there is one centralized question, but how do we, as students, incorporate all of these technologies? How can we start looking into all of these questions in the overarching scheme of things and try to narrow down our, I mean, it would be too hard to look at every question and answer every question, but how do you have any suggestions or advice for starting graduate students in terms of incorporating all of these different technologies and all of these different areas of focus? Kind of a broad question.
I would suggest start with one. So I was thinking about it, and my first recommendation was actually the conceptual incorporations of technology. So my first recommendation was to draw a flowchart first. And I learned tremendously. This is not touching the computer yet. This is draw a flowchart, know where you're going, know where your work start, and how to get to where you want to go to. Somewhere along the way, there will be a time, there will be a place, something can be plugged in to either make your work faster or make your work more accurate or both. And you can also recognize where you have a little gap that you require that requires some other technologies to bridge in. All of this work are conceptual in the beginning stage. And then as we start working on that, the technology flow in naturally. So if I don't know how to solve a problem, I just shoot Mark an email and say, Mark, I'm stuck. Can you help? And then he... Yeah. So so then you get a group of people working together. You get a lot of people who you know something. And then the other things that I will need to learn is to ask questions that other people understand so they can help me. And it takes a while to learn to ask questions to an engineer like Mark. And it takes some time for Mark to learn to talk with the linguistic jargons. So now we actually have a communication channel that that works because people has been already been working for years and have this understanding. So, but then I think all things start with the conceptual issue of drawing a flowchart. So you know where am I stuck, where I can get help, and where I should ask whom. And then the rest will come. The rest will follow, in my own experience.
Be an early adopter. I think the trajectory of a PhD thesis I think hasn't really changed a lot in 50 years. The basic trajectory is you come in really interested in a particular subject, a language that fascinates you or a phenomenon about language that fascinates you, and you have no idea what's known about that subject. And so your advisor gives you a lot of articles to read, and they make no sense. But the more you read, the more they start to make sense. So you have to be an early adopter both of the science and of the technology. Of the science, in the sense, you have to be willing to. We tend to forget this, that you have to be, in order to do this interdisciplinary communication that Chilin was talking about, you have to be willing to say, I really would like to know something about this subject. I'll pick up an article and read it, and I have to not be afraid of the fact that when I read it, I'm only going to understand one word out of 10. But if I read it twice and then go and find other articles that it references and then go and try to understand it a little bit, then I will start to understand more to the point where I can ask intelligent or almost intelligent questions of the people who do understand it. The other thing that actually is surprisingly useful is, in addition to following that standard trajectory of a PhD thesis, play video games and things like that, because a lot of the tech. So, for example, in the course that I'm teaching this fall, which, by the way, you're all I need to extend an open invitation. I'm teaching a course called Signal and Image Analysis, which is designed to teach things like reverberation and motion blur and synthesized speech to non-engineers. If you've taken a calculus course, this course is designed for you. And one of the innovations we're going to try this year is we're going to take all of these audio and video sound effects and make them into movies. And the reason for that is because I have an 11-year-old daughter and a 13-year-old daughter, and they love iMovie. And I thought, well, wow, you know, why not? You know, this is if it's fun and it's a great way to showcase and to motivate the things that that are going to be useful in your research, but they probably won't be useful in your research in the first 2 months that you learn about them. So let's make them useful in some other way in the first 2 months that you're learning about them. So I guess standard PhD trajectory plus early adopter.
One thing that is really nice about these days is that there are, you have the web to be able to find technologies. You don't have to go spend a lot of time coming up to speed with technologies, I think, in my opinion. If you've got a good topic that you want to study and you start delving into the literature, you're going to find what technologies people are using. Whether it's proceedings from the CogSci conference or from, you know, the ACL universe. I mean, there are anthology. There are places out there that document really well what people have used in the past, and it doesn't have to be an obsession to try and catch up with the technology. I think it's pretty easy to do. Of course, going to conferences and talking to people helps a lot as well. The other thing that I was going to mention is that we have, I think, the largest undergraduate linguistics program in the U.S. We've got about 225 or 230 undergraduate majors in linguistics, and one of the things that we're finding is people are asking the same question. And so we started early on in the undergraduate major a class called Linguistic Tools, where this is the second semester we've taught it now, where we take students through all of the, you know, just a superficial kind of exposure to all of the different tools that are out there, whether it's, you know, machine translation or sentiment analysis or part of speech tagging or parsers or, you know, lexicographic tools, things like that, so that they can be thinking early on about what technologies are out there and what they can use in their research when they get down the road and start learning more about theories or application areas and trying to wonder how can I bring this into the fold.
So, go ahead.
I would say also make sure that your use of technology is driven by a theory that you want to test. The research should drive your research, and don't let the methodology, the technology tool, be the thing driving the research. So I think in the case of an eye tracker, you can't just say, I want to use an eye tracker. You have to have a research question that can be answered better through eye tracking technology. And so I think for students, and even for me, some of my best studies, ones that I look back and think, oh, that was really fun. That was easy to do. That produced good results, are replication studies. So if you see something that you've read in class and you know that it could be done a little bit better, you could answer the questions more deeply if you had some actual eye movement data to triangulate, you know, the findings that the other person had. And that's a nice way to start out small, is you would just add the methodology of whatever's being done on an eye tracker. Then the next step is getting access to that tool. And I think that here, I was talking to Amelia. She said there are many classes on psycholinguistics. There are professors here using eye trackers. So volunteer with those professors. Take their classes. See if you can get time on the eye tracker. And start really small. You won't want to start a project with collecting data from 80 people, but maybe you do, you know, 20 of them without the eye tracker and only 5 with. So it's kind of just starting out really baby steps, and I highly recommend replication studies, because then you're not juggling everything. The study design is already complete. You can email the researchers for their materials and then follow their steps of the methodology. I think that's always a nice way to get started on a project. Using a new technology is to follow what's been done before and just add the technology to get at the questions more deeply.
I was going to make the same point in part and continuing with the theme of how things have changed. So as theoretical fields like, you know, theoretical syntax and phonology have become more experimental, now it's a lot easier for students to get involved in professors' research, right? So you just, you know, if you are interested in the work one of your professors is doing, well, ask if you can collaborate, because, you know, experimental work always requires more than one person. It requires a team. And then if you start going to the lab meetings and so on, that gives you an idea of how the whole enterprise of research works in that subfield.
Everyone else spoke. I guess I better say something. One of the most wonderful things about academic writing, dissertations, theses, journal articles, is almost all of them have that nice little section at the end, suggestions for future research. And, you know, I certainly in my own research have gotten some very interesting directions from that, because that's where they say, you know, if I'd done this way, it would have been even better. So it's kind of a replication, but really an extension as well. So it's any student starting a dissertation, I say, look at their intro, look at the end, get some ideas from that.
I have a question that follows up on this, and that is, what do you suggest is the best way to share ideas, right? A lot of work in graduate school can be individually focused, right? You might be a lone wolf out there just deciding, I really want to learn X technology, and you might very well succeed. But the person in the cubicle next to you might be on that same path, and you have these parallel processes, which to me seem inefficient. So I'm wondering, what are your suggestions for sharing? If you have people, we have a lot of new information, we have a lot of big data, we have a lot of new methodologies that all of the separate individuals in our departments are working on. What do you suggest as the best ways for graduate students, for professors, for departments on any level to share these ideas in order to create a larger community that's more knowledgeable?
I've always been really impressed by how well graduate students do this, actually. I mean, there was this talk yesterday where I don't think she's here, said had acknowledgments at the end for the R Whisperer. And I find this in across all departments. My graduate students in Beckman will also share information about how a particular technology is used before I've ever even heard of the technology. So by the time it gets up to by the time a professor hears about it, our instinct is, oh, I should create a mini course, or I should create a course to teach people how to use this technology, or I should integrate it into my course. And as far as I know, that's the only way that we have of giving feedback to you about the use of technologies. But I think that usually that happens 3 years after you need it. So.
Being a lover of technology and computer-mediated communication, I mean, it would be very easy for any of the students to start a nice nerdy wiki to share technology. If there was one for the department, and then as these new technologies evolve, they're added, and you've got videos for instructions. Create a great pool of knowledge. Would not be difficult to do.
I think this happens more in the hard sciences, where a certain data set is collected. The data are collected by a team, and then the team members divide up parts of the data and publish different papers based on different research questions. But I think we're starting to see that in applied linguistics too, where things like eye tracking data are so expensive and time consuming. If you can partner up with someone or create a team with multiple research questions that can be addressed by one set of data, and then you work together to collect that data, but actually continue to work on your qualifying papers separately, because I think there's often a requirement that must be solo authored, right? Do you have that here too? But that's a way where you can give each other feedback, you can share parts, the literature will be based, it'll be the same literature. So sometimes as we start getting more techniques that are time consuming and expensive, then it's more worthwhile to pool resources but divide up how that data is analyzed into different papers. So I think that you'll see more and more of that happening.
So touching on both what Dr. Hualde said and what Dr. Hasegawa-Johnson said, do you see changes in the nature of both undergraduate and graduate education and training in terms of how much technology is integrated into what we consider basic requirements for knowing the subject? Since things like basic requiring people to have a basic knowledge of R, a basic knowledge of Pratt, a basic knowledge of slapping together a Python script to search through a corpus, things like that?
Yes, I do. I mean, the thing is that, so our goal in educating graduate students, to a certain extent undergrads as well, is to produce the next generation of researchers, right? So you need to know whatever you need to know in order to produce new research. So that more and more requires knowledge of instrumental techniques, knowledge of statistics. So all of that needs to be incorporated into the curriculum in linguistics. It cannot be just theoretical knowledge anymore, because that doesn't get published. I mean, with only theoretical knowledge, you won't be able to make a contribution in certain fields in linguistics, right? So you need the technical knowledge as well, so it has to be included. And that's a challenge for us as well, how to incorporate all of that.
I would think in the field of phonetics and phonology,
the trend has been very, very clear that it's going one way into definitely you can propose a theory, but the theory needs to be supported solidly with a very large database. And to manage a very large database, it does require technology. It may be sophisticated technology, it may be basic technology, but the basic ideas is you work fast and you work efficiently and you work accurately. So that is a very good directions to go into that we are approaching. So in that area, we can approach the other fields of social science and hard science in having a massive amount of the data supporting ideas. It is also in this context that statistical knowledge is important, because it's basically a method of proving whether something is there or not, which is going beyond eyeballing an effect. So basically, phonetics and phonology is solidly moving into that direction. Yes, it's completely different from 30 years ago. Right? And from my own view of looking at this, this is a river, no return, it's flowing into the sea, which is a good thing. I think this will make our theory a lot more solid, in a sense that if the theory cannot be supported by data, then the theory doesn't exist.
A caution that I should point out that you probably won't have to deal with as graduate students, but if you become researchers, you will have to deal with, and that is that the technology that you use in your experiments will change dramatically at least once every 10 years. And so what we are trying to teach you is the technology that you need in order to test your experimental, in order to perform experiments now, but also the ability to adopt new technologies as they come out and to identify new technologies that will allow you to ask even more interesting questions 10 years from now.
My mom is 92 years old. She's learning to use Skype. So you can do it.
I just talked with a friend of mine from the UK in Second Life yesterday, actually, and she just mentioned off the cuff, her main background in teaching is in technological training for the K-12 teachers in the UK, and she said one of the new goals there is that all students graduating from high school will have knowledge of some computer programming language, computer programming language, and that kind of tells you the scale we're looking at for the future.
Yeah, I think though some of the technologies are so specialized, you have to think, am I going to use this after I graduate? Will the job that I get have that so that I can continue using it? And if the answer is no, then I think don't become an expert in that technology, because then you might be wasting your time. So for example, we tell our MATSL students in the testing class, if you are going to have access to SPSS, you're going to run all your statistics then in class in SPSS, learn that program. If not, we have a handful of teachers that are going to continue teaching. You're going to have Excel, you're going to use everything. Do everything in this class in Excel so that you're able to do what you're learning beyond the school context as well. And same thing with an eye tracker. We tend to discourage students from learning it intensely if they're not going to go into a job where there are eye trackers, or if they don't want it, they don't see themselves getting them later in their jobs. So I think also, you know, you're looking for the direction of where you're going after you graduate and what tools you're going to use in your work. So definitely learn everything you can if you think that that tool is going to be where you go, but also be choosy. You can't learn everything. You can't be an expert in everything. And if that thing that you're learning is not going to be around after you graduate, then maybe think twice about it.
So one more point. So statistics, which we need to use in our work to apply it to interpret our results, is also an active field of research, and we need to be aware of that. So that keeps changing as well. So for instance, in the work I do, a few years ago we were all happily using ANOVAs. Turns out that for most of the work that we do, ANOVAs are not appropriate, so we have to, that has happened in the last 5 years or so, right? So now we have to learn new statistical models, and things are going to keep changing. So, and that's, again, that's another field that we need to be aware of. And, you know, we don't have to do the research that is going to advance statistics, but we need to be aware of the latest results in that field of knowledge.
So I would like to add one more thing about the use of technology. I always think, probably this is my personal experience, but I think it must be more general, in a sense that the most useful things about technology is not the technology itself. It is the concept behind the harnessing of the technology. Again, you can gain that knowledge without touching the computer, but so it is still on the paper and pencil stage. Again, I'll go back on drawing the flowchart, but it doesn't come with one day. It doesn't come with the first days of practice. We all make mistakes, but as we learn a little bit of technology, that is, you actually have a hands-on experience of technology, I find that the most useful benefit actually come from sharpening your own view about how to solve a problem. How does it happen? It happens because once you have some minimal capability of harnessing the technology to make it faster and more accurately to get your results, then the loop between your hypothesis and the results become very, very fast. Before, it may take 4 months to design an experiment, collect the data, and getting the result, and another 2 months to do the analysis. But a little bit of a technology can reduce the time into a few minutes in the ideal situation. Suppose you get a database that's already collected, but the reducing of the time means that I still remember a hypothesis when I'm analyzing the result. You don't know how important that is. You still have a sharp idea of what a hypothesis is all about, how to move it forward. You are already at what Randy was talking about, the future research. How can I do it better 5 minutes later if you get the results within 5 minutes? And that sharpens your hypothesis in a very quick way, so you can modify the flowchart to the extent that is a very sophisticated research, a piece of research design. The other thing is that conceptually you go through the loop and you know exactly where the system will break. So sometimes we do an experiment after 3 months of data collection and realize, oh, I forgot about this one. And then you have to redo the experiment. But if you go through a conceptual loop ahead of time, and look at the flowchart, I say, oh, I haven't bridged over this particular gap yet. And so this entire project cannot be done. And that's a very tiny, tiny gap. But then that's a river you have no bridge over. So then your research turns into, can I build a bridge to get over this? Can I change my design so I don't need to cross this river? Or do I have a friend who can solve this? If all of those are no, then the research cannot be done, and then you are still on the first day of your flowchart design. So I find that the technology has its most benefit in this area because it crystallizes your concept of the research work, so you can put it on one piece of paper, turn the technology components into boxes and see how things flow and see whether you can get a result conceptually. So my emphasis is still that the benefit of technologies is in the concept learning. And then you can get there by just starting small. Like it builds onto itself very slowly, actually very quickly.
You also asked about institutions. I think institutions are really slow at adopting technology. Technology moves a lot faster than institutions do, which puts the onus on you as a graduate student. It might seem a little harsh, but you should be able to go out and find applications, maybe by talking to your colleagues, talking to professors, doing searches on the web. These days, a lot of technologies are open and free. The price you have to pay is try downloading it, try installing it, try reading the user documentation if you're lucky enough to have any of it. But a lot of it has to be kind of working along with other people. A lot of the things that are produced, a lot of the projects that are produced have support forums where you can ask, hey, I'm having trouble installing this, what did I do wrong, or I got this error message, how can I fix that? That's really a nice tool that's at everybody's disposal. But more often than not, I give advice on students on what technology to use, but often they find it on their own and tell me. I think we're at the era where that's possible. Don't rely on the institution to teach you everything you need to know for the tools that you're going to use for your particular project.
One thing I've been wondering about when listening to the use of technologies, how it's impacted my area of research, which is primarily pragmatics. So clearly data collection has become a lot easier. So not focusing so much on the analysis part, but just the collection part. We've got crowdsourcing, we got, if you're working with CMC, you totally skip the stage of needing to transcribe any of your data. It's all there for you. You've got a huge amount of texts you could pore over. If you're working with internet data, it's the same. I'm wondering if you see any pitfalls too. So I was thinking about flipping the coin over a little bit. We've been talking about the benefits of technology, and I'm thinking about potential pitfalls of having access to, I'm focusing on the idea of having access to perhaps too much data. Is there such thing as too much data? I'm throwing it out there in terms of how could that maybe derail a little bit our focus, our priorities, those are the kinds of things I'm thinking about. But
clearly, there's an ocean of data out there. Can you have too much? Yeah, maybe not. But it's hard to focus. For me, the more interesting question is the ethical dilemmas that come up with online research. I mean, you mentioned many times with CMC, you already have the transcripts. Not if you're in a virtual world where there's oral communication, but I'm waiting for the next great ethical nuclear explosion in online research. If we go back to like the tea room studies, some of you may be familiar with, where this was decades ago, where somebody was doing research on gay men and basically stalked them to collect data and didn't tell them anything, and then went and talked to them and their wives to follow up on the research. In virtual worlds research now, there are a lot of people doing research, but how do you get consent from someone when their avatar name is Funky Bunny 26? That's probably not their real life name. It would be very easy to collect video and audio data in virtual worlds, even if I co-own a couple islands in Second Life. And if you know how to disable camera constraints, I can lift my camera up, look on the other side of the island, look in a house, and listen and hear whatever. But awesome for researchers, unethical as hell, but awesome for researchers. So, there's that caution with this kind of research, and certainly with online research, this has happened before. I'm blanking on the name of the study, but where they were able to access the computer records of a major university because they wanted to see who was surfing for porn. And again, got no permissions and published data that made it very obvious who was surfing for porn, and it was published, and then they got in lots of trouble. So we have ethical dilemmas that are a bit different. The example I use with my students is, if there's a guy in the park with a camera filming you standing 3 feet away in front of you or behind you, chances are he's either a pervert or a researcher, but you can see he's there. But in online research, the researcher many times is absolutely invisible and not present whatsoever. So it places a huge burden on us, I think, as researchers, that we have to think about.
So I want to put a note on why I would say you never have too much data. If you have a lot of data, that there's the technology of sampling and Monte Carlo simulations that can actually allow you to extract information from a very large database. But the large database can give us representations of rare events, which allowed us to understand a lot more about linguistic information. So I would say the only drawback of having too much information could be that prevent us from looking into the information and learn something from the information directly, but that's our own fault. So I think we can be disciplined enough to say, no matter how big my data is, I will at least look at the sample of it, and the sample will be selected with a sampling technique, not whatever data I want to look at. So then that will give us a fair representation of what is out there. So because of that, I would say, yeah, we can always harness more data. And there will be no case under which we have too much data.
I think I should make clear, I totally agree. And of course, it differs by different areas of linguistics as well, I think. What I'm wondering is also the possibility of if you're crowdsourcing, you don't really know who's providing the data. With sociolinguistics, that can be an issue because you are interested in connecting social variables about people and the way they speak. Also, you know, there is the idea of self-reporting or what people are willing to reveal about themselves. These have been classical problems in linguistics, but I wonder if they get compounded by the use of technology to collect the data, in the sense that, you know, I may end up, I've come across people who say, well, we just have to disregard that set of data, that's, you know, or data that comes from this person, that's just bad data. And I always feel awkward about that. I don't feel, like you said, I think it's much better to actually have a principled way of sampling our data. But also, you know, could the technology make that harder, maybe? Because we don't have information about our subjects anymore the way we used to, if, you know. So, like I said, I'm thinking about instances where we don't necessarily know our subjects, which could be either the crowdsourcing or any kind of internet. So, bad data is my
question. You may not know your users, but you know their annotations, and that can actually be very useful. So, there's a whole burgeoning area of, I guess, computational linguistics that deals with the analysis of consistency and inconsistency, how much you can trust, who you can trust, which annotations are better trusted than other types of annotations, and so on. So this is an interesting field because of the use of crowdsourcing. And I'm pretty sure that whatever techniques come up with technology, words are related, there will be words, there will be approaches that allow you to deal with the amount and the quality of data. But those sometimes follow behind rather than lead. Those technologies have to be developed in response to what's happening as people are using technology in different ways. So you just have to, you know, there is some interesting work in this area, and it's growing very quickly. And this goes back to the comment that it might just be 1 or 2 years before whatever you have you need to use will be in place. In the meantime, do the other stuff, and it'll catch up with you. And it'll be, if you're lucky, the timing is will be really important for you.
Amelia, is it related to this, or because I have another question from? Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to comment. I actually get this type of feedback quite a lot on my data. I collect crowdsourced data, and people say,
well, that data is worse than the data I collect in my lab. Or if you get, and so, right, and you know less about your subjects. Or I collect recordings out in the world, and they're noisier, quite literally, than recordings you do in the lab. I think it is the case in that sense that some of this data is bad data, but or worse data than data we've collected in the past in the lab. But my response to that is there's just so much more of it that, statistically speaking, if we have conclusions that are robust to that noise, that's still a better way to go, to have a much, much, much larger set of data that is slightly noisier. And that's one of my responses to when people say that. I don't know if you all get these criticisms as well.
I guess I would add to that that you do need to, I mean, you say having a lot of data can alleviate to some extent the fact that in some sense it's worse data. I wouldn't say worse, I would say different, and you need to be aware of those differences. This is what you were saying, that the knowledge of what can happen when you're collecting data online and the knowledge of how the techniques, the kinds of questions you can ask of your online annotators in order to detect or compensate for those problems evolves a year or two after the initial data collection technique. And but knowing how to do that kind of fact checking is necessary to have valid experimental results. And if your reviewers of your paper are on the ball, they'll call you on it. And if you don't see those problems if you don't know about those problems and compensate them for them during your data collection phase, you'll have problems later on. So that is something you need to be careful about. Just imagine what can happen, read other people's studies to try to figure out what can happen, and then find ways to compensate or detect those errors as they happen. There's a great example actually in Amelia's talk yesterday. She talked about how when you're doing transcription of stop closures, and if the stop is phrase initial, then there you don't know when the closure happened, and so undergraduates who are first learning how to do phonetic transcription will just say, well, the stop is this piece, this release, it's five milliseconds long, and automatic forced alignment systems will do the same thing. And I've seen actually papers that have gone into review in linguistics journals where it was obvious that they were doing the same thing, that they had used forced alignment in order to collect their phoneme durations, and they didn't discriminate between phrase initial and phrase medial stop closures because they didn't know that that was a problem because they never looked closely enough at the data. So that's this is an example of a phenomenon that's well known, well understood. There are very excellent techniques for compensating for it, but you need to be aware of it.
We just have one more minute. Actually, I think we're out of time, but I have a question from our ILLS group online from a student who's been watching the whole thing on live stream. So her name is Jessica Nicholas, and she asks, I'm curious about how people view the role of computer coding and statistical modeling in the future of linguistics education and in the field in general. Coming from the humanities, coding is something that I felt blindsided by. I know that there are some professors who explicitly teach it in their courses, and there have been some excellent workshops, but in the large part, it's something that many of us are expected to pick up on in our spare time or teach each other. I'd like to hear some opinions about the extent to which all of us may need to be prepared to teach it to our own students in the future. How can we best be prepared for quickly changing technological needs like this?
First of all, to be a linguist, you don't need to know how to program necessarily, depending on which area of linguistics you're interested in. If you want to be a computational linguist, then you need to know computer science as well as linguistics. So we've had a program for about 30 years, computers and linguistics, or computers in the humanities, where we've tried to teach people how to program, even though they're not in a computer science program. That had mixed results. That program no longer exists as of fairly recently. Programming is a field that changes very quickly. The prevailing programming languages change over time. And I think that the time that it takes to invest to learn how to program is probably prohibitive unless you want to be a programmer. People who do want to be programmers will learn either in classes or these days there are excellent tutorials on how to program in a particular language. I think not everybody needs to learn how to program to be a linguist, and I don't think all linguistics classes need to have a component, or even linguistics programs have to have a component where you learn how to program. That said, I think there are some tools that most linguists should know, things like how to use a regular expression, maybe how to do Perl scripting or Python scripting to access at a lower level some of the data that you might want to manipulate, especially when there's a lot of data that's being collected. Of course, everybody knows anyway how to use Excel or so on, but using a more sophisticated statistical package or graphing package will help a lot. But I think there's less and less of a demand or need to learn how to program, how to actually use a programming language to be able to use a lot of the tools. You don't need to know how to program how to use Pratt. Or in order to use Pratt, you can use scripting, and that's its own programming approach in and of itself. If you were using parsers, you might, syntactic parsers, you might need to use a different type of high-level declarative language, but you don't need to learn Java or C++ or whatever to do most of the work that people do, I think, these days in linguistics. If your interest pull you in that direction, fine, learn some, but I don't think that it's mandatory, and I don't think that every person who gets a PhD in linguistics needs to know how to program.
Yeah, I think that's right. I concur, but I think you should be selective, and I know we teach in our MATSL program how to design materials online. Teachers get frustrated. They're like, I can't get that photo to go in the upper right-hand corner, and I'll say, oh, well, open it up in the HTML and type in float left or float upper right, use some coding. And that's where I realized that students today, they don't know HTML. So they open up the HTML file and it looks like gobbledygook. So in that case, I say, oh, well, if this is going to be useful for you, if learning HTML, get the book HTML for Dummies. Let's work through it. Learn the basic code. So don't be afraid of it. Find out what it is exactly that you need to learn. If you need to learn Python to run something, or if you need to learn HTML to better design your materials online, then I think folks have workshops that you can sign up for, or there are books that you can buy. So I think being very selected in finding out what you do need to know and not just learning it in a void, saying I'm going to learn C++. Because if you have no practical application for it, there's no reason to learn it. So I do encourage any student who's doing online materials design to learn HTML so you can open it up and look at it and fix the little tweaks that you need. But I don't think it involves in-depth knowledge. As long as you have the resource manual, you can always look things up. So I think the key is not to be afraid of it. You can learn a little bit, and that will teach you how to learn more. So I think some basic programming is good if you need it. If you find it's a hole, that you're not able to do something because you don't know it, then definitely see how you can learn it. Yeah.
I think that's all we have time for. It's been very educational. Thank you. A big thank you to all our panelists and the audience as well. We're almost nearing the end of ILLS. I now request the director of SLCL, Professor Jean-Philippe Mathy, to give away the award for the top abstract and say a few words about ILLS. Yes. Okay, sure. Of course.
I just, on behalf of our School of Literature, Cultures, and Linguistics, I want to thank all of you for coming to this conference, both invited speakers and paper presenters. And also, I want to congratulate the students for putting this event on the map every year. We all know that it's a lot of work to organize a conference, And all this is done on top of their studies, of your research, of your dissertation writing. So big thanks for that. Interim director of the school, I've had the opportunity to have more contacts with my colleagues in linguistics and my linguist colleagues in other departments in the school. And I've gotten to learn a lot about the discipline and being impressed by the breadth of the discipline, but also the dynamism of the discipline, the energy that's behind it. And certainly the roundtable was an example of that. I mean, as an outsider, it was fascinating to see how a discipline is changing, how new paradigms are emerging, new methodologies, and the kind of problems that this technology is posing to you as researchers, as social scientists. So I just want to say that this kind of evolution, particularly the introduction of technology, is also challenging the school itself. On the one hand, in a positive way, I would say it's challenging the school because as new positions are crafted, for example, there's been a new position proposed by linguistics and the Center for Translation Studies for a tenure track position in machine translation. So that gives us an opportunity to talk to other people in computer science and other sciences. And that's of course very positive. Now it's challenging too because we are now hiring people who come from a different universe. And usually when they come in, they don't only need a salary and an office, but they need a lab, right? And so that pushes us to in terms of managing the school, to go into very different directions. And so it's another challenge, but I think it's a welcome challenge as the discipline of linguistics is moving in different directions. So again, congratulations to all of you and to the students who organized this, and I look forward to seeing many more ILLS conferences in the future. Thank you.
And we have all three of the top four abstracts, though. One of them had to go back early, so I will announce the ones who are here. One of the top four abstracts for ILLS6 is Jen Griffin. Amelia Kimball. And Laurel Brem. The fourth person who won the top four abstracts was Jackson Lee. He had to leave on Friday, so a round of applause for him as well, please. A certificate of participation for the couple of presenters who are here today. Laurel Schenkosk. I don't know how to pronounce it. I'm so sorry. And Kate Lyons. Have I missed out anybody who is here and who presented? Thank you so much.
And I would like to thank the ILLS committee, and I think we should all give them a round of applause for the wonderful work they've done at this conference. Thank you to Chaitra, Iftikhar, who's back there, Philo, Julie, and Clara.
So on a closing note, I'd like to again thank everybody who's been involved in this conference. Firstly, a big thank you to all the participants and invited speakers, especially Professor Lonsdale and Professor Winke, who came down from far away.
I'm so far away, but still.
And special thanks to the School of Literatures, Cultures, and Linguistics, the Student Affairs Program Coordinating Council, and SORF for funding us, and the participating departments, Department of Psychology, Linguistics, Spanish, Italian, and Portuguese, East Asian Studies, English, Classics, Unit of Criticism and Interpretive Theory, and of course ECE. Thanks to the library for the equipment and the Discourse Social Interaction and Translation Lab. Thanks to people who have worked alongside us since the beginning of the conference, Brad Miller, our social chairs who are here today, Ichaso and Kate and Lydia, who's not here right now, and Avinash Ahuja for helping us with the live streaming. Thank you to all the faculty members, staff, and students from the FLB and the undergrads who participated this time, and we hope your participation just increases over time. A very, very big thank you and a special mention to all the previous ILLS committees, especially ILLS 5. They just set the standard so high, and we did our best to reach them. So I hope we've done our best, and it only gets better from now on. Thank you, everybody, for coming out to the conference, and I hope you had a good time. It was a very enriching experience for all of us, and we had a lot of fun. I hope it was the same for all of you as well. Thank you. Does anybody want to say anything else? I'm done, though.